Welcome to Centenary United Methodist Church. My name is Robert Gorell, and I'm one of the pastors here. I wanted to share some announcements with you this morning. Tonight at 6 o'clock, from 6 to 7:15, our youth will be meeting in the building. Masks and social distancing are required, but it was a great time Sunday night when we started back up. We had a fabulous group, and if you have a youth in your family, we hope that you'll plan on having them here. And you may not know, if you had somebody in your family enter the sixth grade this year, they are eligible for youth. Contact me for more information or just come to the church on Sunday nights at 6, and we'd love to have our new sixth graders as a part of the group. On Wednesday nights, children are meeting, also with masking and social distancing. They meet from 6 to 7:15 Wednesday nights in the Activity Center, and it's a great opportunity for our children to be together. I hope if you have children, they'll be able to come. Our charge conference is November 13th at 7 p.m. That's the official meeting of the year where we review the year with our district superintendent. If you're on the church council, or if you chair a committee in the church or a work area, you are invited to be at charge conference. It is on Zoom. Call the office if you need more information or check the newsletter. Then on the 28th, we'll be having neighborhood breakfast. We've done one of those now outdoors where we simply hand out a sack meal to people, and it was greatly appreciated. That will happen again on November 28th. The breakfast starts at 9. If you'd like to volunteer, contact Sarah Riddle or the church office, and we'll get you set up to be a volunteer for neighborhood breakfast. Today we continue our sermon series on resilience. What does it mean to be resilient at a time like this? I think it's going to be very, very meaningful to all of us. Thank you for worshiping with us today at Centenary.
Good morning, Refuge. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. God, prepare our hearts and our minds for this service, for your worship. Wherever we are, in our homes, in our cars, wherever we're listening, just let that be a holy place, God. Let us know that you are there and that you're present. We look forward to this day and to your word. It's in your Son's name that I pray. Amen. Let us worship. The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, for me, who brings our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King.
Grace and peace to you in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Good morning and welcome to the Refuge at Centenary United Methodist Church. It is a joy to be with you here today as we come together for our worship. This is the Refuge, and it is a place where we come to get away, a place where we are safe in the arms of God, apart from the rhythms of the world. But I think it's also important to name what we bring with us when we come into worship. So this has been a long and stressful week, and some of us come in today with relief and excitement. Others come in today with anger and disappointment. But I want to let you know that you are welcome here. You are welcome to worship with us. We all answer to God. Our purpose is to worship God and to serve our neighbor. And that's what we as the church are called to do and what we will continue to do no matter what else is going on in our nation or the world around us. And so I am so glad that we get to be here today to talk about how we continue to worship God and how God makes us conquerors. How God gives us the strength and the resilience to get up each day and do what we are called to do, to serve God, to worship God, and to love our neighbors. Will you join me as we continue in that worship and an attitude of prayer? Holy God, you are Lord. Our allegiance is to you and to your kingdom, and we put our full trust in your grace. Because of your love for us, our hearts are full and our spirits rejoice that you are here in this place with us. So no matter what we feel today, may we know that you are here. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Mercy never fails me, oh my dear.
This last month, we had an opportunity to resume one of our long-standing ministries at Centenary. We've had to shut down our neighborhood breakfast since the COVID pandemic began, but in October, we were able to do a to-go breakfast. On October 24th, we served breakfast outside in to-go bags to about 45 guests who came by the church, and we were able to take about 60 bags to different ministries around the area to share. Right around this church, there are people in need, and I'm so happy that we get to reach out and connect with them. Some people that don't join us for worship services or other ministries, but come and eat breakfast with us. We're happy to make that connection with them again. We're very happy that this ministry is continuing, and we thank you for your support. It's your giving that makes this ministry possible. It's also the giving of time for our volunteers who came on a Friday afternoon to pack bags, on a Saturday morning to heat up sausage biscuits and pancake and sausage on a stick, and who stood out in the cold to give away these bags. We'll be continuing in November with another to-go neighborhood breakfast. It will be on November the 28th at 9:00 in the morning. We'll also be preparing meals on Friday afternoon, the 27th, about 2:00, if you want to come by and help. Please let Sarah Riddle know if you're interested or want more information, or you can contact the office. We're happy that this ministry is continuing, even though it looks a little different now. We're continuing to do ministry in Lawton during the pandemic. Thank you. We thank you for your support of this ministry and all of the ministries here at Centenary. Whether you're able to be here in person or not, this is your ministry. This is what you're doing here in the community to help others. And we give God the glory for that work, which your generosity provides. We'll be collecting our offering with the basket next to the door. You can place your offering in as you leave the service today. You can also give online at lawtoncentenary.org, or you can bring your offerings by the church during the week. Will you join me as we bless these offerings? Gracious God, we give you thanks for the many gifts that you pour out upon us. We turn some of those back to you now. May they be used for the building of your kingdom in this place and around the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Everlasting, your light will shine in all.
Not a moment passes by that we realize that you aren't there, that you aren't moving. We know that you are ever present, and we trust in you.
Yeah.
Our scripture today comes from Revelation 3. Listen, I am standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come into you and eat with you, and you with me. To the one who conquers, I will give a place with me on my throne, just as I myself conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Melt us, mold us, fill us, use us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Amen. God's reign is already present on earth in a mystery. When the Lord comes, it will be brought to perfection. That is the hope that inspires Christians. We know that every effort to better society, especially when injustice and sin are so ingrained, is an effort that God blesses, that God wants, and that God demands of us. These are the words of Saint Oscar Romero. He was an archbishop in El Salvador, and before his death, he advocated for the poor, and he helped navigate his nation through a time of civil unrest, of violent civil unrest, a time of death squads and assassinations, a time of mistrust, a time of fear. In fact, it's said that the government officials would listen to Bishop Romero's radio productions, his weekly radio show, so that they would know what was going on in the country on the ground, because they knew he would tell the truth in a time of misinformation and media censorship. Bishop Romero was a man of resilience, a man who never grew tired of doing God's will, a man who helped the poor, who fed the hungry, who cared for the sick, and who spoke for the voiceless in the face of immense pressure and danger and persecution. In fact, he kept working even when a close friend of his, who was also a priest, was assassinated for doing similar work. Romero knew, as you could tell in that quote that I read, that God was already reigning on earth, that God was already in control, that God was in charge. But for now, it's a mystery. It doesn't always look like God is in control. In the midst of chaos and violence and fear and confusion, it's hard to see the kingdom of God. But Romero worked day in and day out to help others see that kingdom. His ministry and the ministry of others that he inspired, the point of it was to help others see the kingdom of God, that God was already reigning, that God was in control, and God cared about you. No matter where you came from, no matter your status, God loves you. God is in charge. That was the message of Bishop Romero, and that was the message of the book of Revelation. It's full of all kinds of strange images, dragons and beasts and animals and fire. But at the center of all of that vivid imagery and disturbing scenes, there is a throne. And on that throne, there is the Lamb, Jesus, who sits on the throne with the Father, who is reigning. As I mentioned last week, that's not a vision of the future that John paints for us when he wrote the book of Revelation. That was a vision of the present, that God was already on the throne and in control when everything else was swirling chaos and disarray. Jesus is Lord. The section that we read from today that Gus read, it comes from a part of the book that is seven letters to seven churches in the area of Asia Minor, which today we call Turkey. And these seven letters to these seven churches, they each have a compliment for each church, a critique for each church, and an encouragement. So something you're doing well, something you need to fix, and then an encouraging message to keep going. And all added up together, these letters tell us that Jesus is both Lord in charge over the fray, but also walking down to earth with us in our suffering and in our struggles. It says that Jesus holds the churches in his hand, while at the same time he walks among them in our footsteps with us. The passage today comes from the seventh letter, the last one, to the church at Laodicea. And Laodicea was a comfortable church. It was different from the other letters because this letter had no compliments. Jesus couldn't think of anything nice to say about this church. How's that for a wake-up call? Laodicea was a wealthy city, a comfortable city. And the church, they were wealthy and comfortable too. They thought they were self-sufficient, that they didn't have to worry about anything else. They thought that they were going swimmingly. But Jesus can't even say anything nice about them. In fact, here's part of their critique. Jesus says, "You say I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing. You do not realize that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked." Ouch. Laodicea is a church trying to do things on their own, a church that thinks that it has conquered, that thinks that the work is done, that thinks that it has already brought the kingdom of God, but they are not there yet. But even though they have no bright spots, nothing positive that Jesus can point towards, Jesus has not abandoned them. Instead, Jesus says, "I stand at the door and I knock. I want in. I want to come in and be with you and eat with you and share time with you. Not to come in and condemn and to judge, but to save. I want you to be conquerors," Jesus tells the church. "But you're not there yet, and you need my help to get there. So let me in." Laodicea thought that they were conquering. They thought that they were self-sufficient and in control and able to call their own shots. And isn't that what it means to conquer? To answer to no one, to be your own boss, to be in charge, to not worry about what anybody else has to say. But that's not what Jesus means when he tells them to conquer. That's not how Jesus conquered. He didn't conquer with might or with force or with coercion. Jesus conquered on a cross. Jesus conquered in his death through sacrifice. Jesus remained faithful and obedient to God. When things got difficult, he didn't look for an easy way. He kept going. He kept remaining faithful to what God was calling him to do, and for that he conquered. In fact, throughout the book of Revelation, John talks about those who conquer. This isn't the only time that John talks about conquering and invites the churches to conquer. But each time he's not talking about a military victory are overwhelming force and power. Whenever John talks about those who conquer, he's talking about those who remained faithful, those who stayed obedient to God. You see, John was writing to Christians living in the Roman Empire. And when in Rome, you were expected to do what the Romans did, to worship the emperor, to make sacrifices to their gods. The expectation was allegiance to Rome, but John is calling the church to allegiance to God. And if you remain faithful to God, if you don't follow the emperor, if you don't fall into their system, you are a conqueror. You have persevered. You have stayed with it in the face of immense pressure to abandon your faith. And those who remain faithful are conquerors worthy of a place on the throne with Jesus and the Father. The one who conquers is not automatically a wealthy person or a powerful person. The one who conquers is not the one who controls the most people. The one who conquers is the one who remains faithful to God. The one who lived like and followed Jesus. Conquering was as simple as opening the door and eating with Jesus. I said simple, but not easy. It took resilience. It took endurance to stand up to that kind of pressure and remain faithful. And when I think of resilience and when I think of endurance, I think of marathon runners. I've run a couple of marathons, but I'm talking about people who do this for a living, people who are professional runners who run upwards of 100 miles a week, who can run 26 miles in a little over 2 hours. That's a picture of endurance and resilience. And one of the most successful marathoners in America is a woman named Des Linden. If there's a such thing as a blue-collar runner, it's Des. She lives in Michigan, and she is known for doing her workouts, her 20-mile runs, in freezing cold weather on icy roads and driving snow. She is tough. She's got this mantra that she uses when she's training and running. She says, "Keep showing up." She doesn't do anything fancy. She doesn't do as much science and nutrition as some of the other runners. She just shows up and she runs, no matter the weather, no matter the temperature, no matter who else is with her. She just shows up and she runs. And that paid off for her in 2018 at the Boston Marathon with perhaps the worst running conditions in history, 40 degrees and driving rain with winds like 30 miles an hour the whole time. It was miserable. I had some friends who actually ran in that race, and it was awful. In fact, it was so tough, most of Dez's competition didn't even finish the race. But Dez, who just keeps showing up day after day, no matter what the conditions, she won. That's resilience. It's nothing fancy. It's nothing complicated. It's nothing tricky. It's just showing up, putting one foot in front of the other over and over again until you've reached your goal. It's that resilience that makes you a conqueror. Day after day, putting one foot in front of the other to follow after Christ. That's what makes you resilient disciples, able to follow God's will, worthy of being called a conqueror and sitting on the throne with Jesus. Some days just waking up is conquering. Some days just getting out of bed is conquering. But in those slow times, in those difficult times when we have to live day by day or even hour by hour, God doesn't ask for anything fancy or complicated. God just asks for the next step. For you to keep showing up, to keep conquering. That's what resilience is all about. To just keep going. There's this relationship between resilience and conquering. We know that we have won. We know that Jesus is on the throne. We know that God is in control. But it's our task to join him. And that takes work day after day. Because I'll admit, it is hard to stand up here and tell you that God is in control in the midst of a pandemic and a contentious election and poverty and racism and sexism and fear and anger. It is a mystery how the kingdom of God can be present amidst all of that junk. We call that mystery the paradox of the now and the not yet. God's kingdom is now. We don't have to wait. But it's not perfect yet. Here on earth, it is still defiled by sin and pain and suffering and death. And that's a mystery. Knowing that God is in control does not mean that we get to stop working, or that we get to rest, or that we get to just sit back and let God handle all of the problems. That's not what Bishop Romero did. He knew that God was in control and that the kingdom of God was here, but he kept working day after day until his death. You see, that quote that I shared with you from Bishop Romero was from his last sermon. God's reign is already present on earth in a mystery. When the Lord comes, it will be brought to perfection. That is the hope that inspires Christians. We know that every effort to better society, especially when injustice and sin are so ingrained, is an effort that God blesses, that God wants, and God demands of us. He finished his sermon. He turned to the altar to bless communion. Some even say that he had picked up the bread and was holding up the host. And with his arms held out, he was shot in the heart by an assassin. Why such suffering still exists is a mystery. But death does not mean defeat for Christians. Jesus won victory through death on a cross. Jesus defeated death through his resurrection. And even after his death, Oscar Romero is a conqueror who now joins all of the other witnesses surrounding the throne and praising God, who are witnesses to the victory of the Lamb. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. What is your marathon today? What is your struggle to get through the next step? What will resilience look like for you this week? Whatever it is, know that God is with you, that God is in control, and may that victory give you the strength to make it through. As we sing this final song, if you need some time in prayer to think about that, we have our altars open. I'll go over and light the candle so that you can light a prayer candle if you would like. And I'll also be over by this door if anybody would like to spend some time in prayer with me, or if there's anything that we can be praying for you together. If you're joining us online, I invite you to either share a prayer concern, what you're looking for, resilience, in the comments, or you can send us a message directly, and we'd love to pray with you and for you. Let us continue our worship now as we give thanks and ask for resilience.
God, as you send us forth into this world, just be with us. Carry us, lead us, guide us. Let us be resilient for you. It's in your name we give these thanks and this praise. Amen. We surrender. One, two, three.